Again, thank you everybody for being here. We're so thankful and honored by your presence. I hope you have your Bibles. If not, I hope you have some kind of electronic device that has a Bible on it. If so, please open up just to start with, just to kind of set the tone for the lesson of this hour. 1 Peter 1:13. 1 Peter 1:13. And I'll give you a second to turn or push your way there. We'll read that and then we'll kickstart the lesson. 1 Peter 1:13. Peter writes, "Wherefore gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ." As I said, when everyone first got here, we had several people come in after I'd already made the opening announcements, but we're very thankful for your presence. And just to let you know the order of events, we'll have a short lesson, we'll sing some songs, and then we'll allow our regular 6 o'clock crowd to file in and find a seat, and then we'll sing some songs from the songbook, and then have a short, condensed sermon that really will just kind of put a capper on the lesson you're about to hear in just a second. Then there's pizza for everybody. Hopefully, there's pizza for everybody. My wife, yes, okay, there's pizza for everybody. And cookies and drinks and such. I want to read something that relates to the topic that we're going to consider, which I won't tell you what it is, but maybe you have a good guess based on the verse that we read. Back in the days of the ancient Near East, so we're looking at the Palestinian, Canaanite area, it was customary, it wasn't unusual at all for both men and women to wear long, flowing gowns, robes, tunics, whatever word you want to put on them. They wore them because it was hot and dry, and the tunics were airy and breezy, and it felt nice. So the men had no problem wearing them either. But if you had to go off into battle and you had this, essentially a muumuu that went down to your ankles, it was hard to do much fighting. So they would do what was called girding the loins, which was a fancy way of tucking the lower part of the skirt up into the belt, or girdle, the belt, and then having essentially now a pair of shorts that you can go off and charge into battle. And eventually, over time, that expression, gird up your loins, just became a synonym for get ready, the fight is now on, or prepare yourself, the enemy is here. It's essentially a war cry. If you heard the shout, everyone gird up your loins, you might giggle, no one there was giggling, they would immediately say, okay, it's time to fight. So essentially, it was a call to arms. And I wanted to take that and apply it in a spiritual way, and I'm not even making the application. Peter, in the verse we just read, makes the application. When he wrote to the brethren and said, "Wherefore, brethren, gird up your loins," he wasn't actually saying, "Hike up your skirts." He wasn't saying, "Tie them into your belt, let's go actually physically fight." We'll read another verse from Paul, or rather a whole series of verses from Paul, that put that statement in its proper spiritual context, how we are to, as Christians today, gird up our loins. For the convenience of our visual learning, if you're like me, I'm a visual learner, I'm going to give you some slides. They're just to run through them, and then I'll be done with the slides, and then we'll just go straight from the Bible from there on. But the reason we're doing this is because my wife wouldn't let me wear one of her pregnancy gowns, so we'll just look at it on the screen. My wife is expecting a child. If you didn't know that, please pray for me. The tunic wouldn't allow you to do heavy labor or fight in battle, necessitating the girding of one's loins. So that's why they do it. So here's how it works. Here's how you do it. You hike it up to there so that you have the fabric by the knees. I got this from the internet. It has to be true. Hike it up to there. You cinch it in the front. Gather it up. Pull it behind you like a diaper. Swing it around in two halves. Tie it. And then look at this guy. Is this guy not ready for fighting? Now you might look at this person's expression, loins girded, giant, pointy sword swinging, and the expression of madness on his face, and you might think, no one would ever make that face in any circumstance. But I was at the Razorback game last night, and Ryan took off to charge the field with 70,000 other people, making that exact expression. Unfortunately, his loins were not girded. He ran in blue jeans, but that's okay. So that's it, essentially. That's the process whereby one girds one's loins. Makes sense? I shouldn't turn that off. We have one more song. That's okay. I'll turn it over. You might see that as you think, what possible application can there be? How could one possibly look at that person making his gown into a diaper, into any kind of, and preparing to be ferocious in battle and make any kind of spiritual application? But as I said, there has to be one, because Peter writes to Christians, not to physical soldiers, but to spiritual soldiers, and says, do that in a spiritual way. Gird up your loins. How does one do that? Stay out of Peter now. Jump over to Ephesians and look at chapter 6. And let's start in verse 10. We'll spend the remainder of our time looking at this famous text from Ephesians chapter 6. As I said, I hope you brought your Bibles. There's nothing on the screen. This is just you, me, and the Word of God. I want us to just do a little Bible study. We're going to take this verse by verse so we can properly understand what it means for us as the Christian soldier to adequately prepare ourselves. Christ is saying to us as soldiers, gird up your loins. It's time to go to battle. What does that mean? How do I do that? Where do I go? Who do I fight? Why am I fighting? Etc. Let's notice the first verse to introduce this concept. Ephesians 6, look at verse 10. Paul writes, finally, my brethren, finally because he's at the end of the letter, now here's the material. My brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. That's the King James. The power of Jesus' might is given to those who receive Jesus' salvation, according to John 1, 12. It is the mental, among other things, the mental fortitude needed to withstand, as he'll talk about later, the evil day. Not a 24-hour period, not an occasional bad day, but the evil era of time in which we live, where we, God's people, are grossly outnumbered, and everybody, from every angle it seems, is firing arrows at us. I need to strap on some armor. What armor do I wear? How do I prepare myself? Paul says, be strong. Here's how you prepare yourself in the Lord. Do so with the power not of yourself, but the power of His might. Listen. Be strong in the power of His might. Your enemy will tell you that because you claim allegiance to Christ, that you hold to a crutch. Christianity is just a crutch. You're a weak person, they will say derogatorily. You're just a weak person, and so you need something to lean on, and so you rely on Christianity as a crutch. If I may humbly say, yes, I am a weak person. I cannot stand on my own. I am not so foolish to think as I can stand on my own. I need a crutch. Jesus Christ offers me a crutch in the form of the cross. If I don't have that crutch, I will not stand. I will fall, according to Paul in 1 Corinthians 12. So Paul says, be strengthened in the power of His might. Lean on Him like a crutch. Ephesians 6, look at verse 11. How do I do that? Put on the whole armor of God. Why? So that you may be able to stand against the wiles, King James says, of the devil. Paul says, he'll say in the next verse, that the fight that you fight, don't look at it yet, that the fight that you fight is not a physical one. You are not going to take a sword like that maniac in the picture that we closed out with. You're not going to take an actual sword that can actually slice a person's gut open and go cutting off people's heads or anything. That's not the kind of fight you fight. You're fighting an intellectual fight. You're fighting a philosophical fight. You're fighting a spiritual battle. You need, therefore, a spiritual kind of armor. Put on the armor of God, not the armor of man. Once you stop saying to yourself, how am I going to get myself out of this? Then you put on the armor of God. As long as you're saying, how am I supposed to do this? You're just trying to wear the armor of man, fighting a spiritual battle. You're going to lose every single time. You're fighting not man. You're fighting the devil. We've got to get it out of our heads that that person over there who's not a Christian is my enemy. He's not your enemy. That person over there who's not a Christian is just a blind slave to your enemy. That person over there who is just listening to what he's hearing whispered in his ear, metaphorically speaking, by the devil, and he's just repeating the vomit that the devil spews. He's not your enemy. The devil who's whispering to him is your enemy. You're not fighting them. You're trying to save them. You're fighting Satan himself. And that's a lot scarier prospect. If you tell me I'm fighting that guy over there who looks kind of like me, well, I can handle that. That's, 50-50, best shot. I can take him. I'm not fighting another person. I'm fighting an angel with an army of angels, if I may say, hell-bent, literally, on me going there with them, spending eternity with them in the dark and demonic place of hell. So you're standing against the schemes, the wiles of Satan, not his followers. You got narrow vision if you think you're fighting them. Next verse, verse 12. Why do I wear the armor of God? Because we wrestle, literally, to throw and be thrown, just like in the actual wrestling. We wrestle, we spar, but in a spiritual application, not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world. Notice, I don't fight the servants of principalities, leaders, magistrates, and rulers. I fight the concept of principalities and powers. I fight the idea of leadership that pushes me to evil. Leadership in general, not the people who are leaders, but the sinful leadership that consumes the majority of this world. I'm fighting against the concept of sin. Don't you seem a little outnumbered? Do you feel like you're not adequately prepared? How are you supposed to fight, not sinners, but sin? You need a spiritual armor. And one, incidentally, spiritual weapon, we'll get to in a little. That's why we don't, because this is a spiritual battle. This is why we don't lash out physically when we are physically hurt or even emotionally hurt. We don't do like Saul of Tarsus did. I don't agree with their religion, the Christian religion, so I'll go arrest them and maybe even kill them. That's not how we do things. Other religions might do that. Christianity doesn't work that way. We're fighting a spiritual battle. Verse 13, Ephesians 6. Wherefore, because of that, take unto you the whole armor of God. Why? So that you may be able to withstand in that evil era, the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Our fight is against an army of evil angels, not against evil people. And so without the right tools, without the proper armor, we would have no hope to defeat this evil army. So Paul says here in this verse, you need to pick up, literally. My Bible says, take unto you. But literally, the word is, it's laying at your feet, pick it up. You don't have to go looking for it. You don't have to seek it out. It's right there. Did everyone bring a Bible or a Bible electronic substitute? It's right here. It tells you everything you need, how to have this particular armor on. It's lying at your feet. You don't have to seek it out and search it like Indiana Jones. It's there. Paul says you just need to pick it up. Thankfully, you can. And thankfully, God has specifically form-fitted this armor for you. Remember David, who was going to go out and fight Goliath? He couldn't wear Saul's armor. We'll get to that at 6 o'clock. He didn't need Saul's armor. But Saul thought, here, you need the physical armor. He says, I have God on my side. Your armor doesn't fit me. You're going to wear a spiritual armor. This armor fits you perfectly. It was tailor-made by God. Look at verse 14. Stand therefore, having your, now finally we get to the armor, your loins gird, here's our sermon, gird about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness. Just stop, there's more to it, but let's just take this verse. The first article of armor describes the belt. As you listen to this, and I know you've heard this, you know, this text preached to you a dozen times, I'm probably not telling you anything new, but as you read this, make sure you're visualizing the physical equivalent of it. It's a spiritual equivalence, but there's a physical component around which the idea is based. A Roman centurion who first, when he hears the call of battle, buckles his belt. Now, typically, we put our belts on last, but they put their belt on first. They cinched up their undergarment with the girdle, and all the armor went around it. And once the Roman soldiers cinches that belt, once he locks that belt in, and however way the belt was designed, once that belt was securely fastened, he was saying to himself, that's it. It's go time. I can't stop now. I've started. There's the point of no return. So once you, Christian, snap on this belt, you're saying to God, I'm on your side. I'm ready to fight. Are you prepared for that? You don't have a say in the matter. He's commanded you to take it up. Just know the heavy weight you're now putting on. You have to gird yourself. Not with a belt, though, but a spiritual one. You are surrounding yourself, wrapping yourself up in truth. Surround yourself, wrap yourself, cinch tight every other element of armor you're going to put on in the concept of truth. His word is truth. His very essence and nature is truth. We read a verse in the sermon this morning from Hebrews 6, where one of the very things that define the nature of God is He can't lie. If He ever said He'd do it and then didn't do it, He'd be a liar, He'd cease to be God, and we're all wasting our time here in the first place. His very nature means He's not allowed to lie. Everything He says is truth. Wrap yourself in the truth of God. You're fighting on the right side, the correct side. Wrap yourself up in truth, the second piece of armor. After you gird your loins in truth, you strap on. You literally cinch airtight without a millimeter of separation between the armor and your skin, the breastplate. There was no gap in between the breastplate and the chest on which it rested. You strap on the breastplate for the Christian of righteousness. The Roman centurion put on the breastplate to protect his vital organs so that if he got punched or if he had a wild flying arrow, a rogue arrow come, hopefully, and at just the right angle, that breastplate would be the difference between him bleeding out and dying and just having a very bad day and a big bruise right here in his midsection. All the vital organs of the body, almost every one, almost, is here in your torso, and that breastplate protected it. You have cinched close to your vital spiritual organ, the heart of man, in the application, the breastplate of righteousness. That which separates you from the lost is that you are righteous. You are right in the sight of God. He doesn't look at you and say, look at this horrible sinner. He looks at you and says, it's just as if he'd never sinned. Just divine, never sinned. He looks at you differently because you have on a breastplate. You see, because the Roman centurion All belonged to the same army of Rome, but all came from different families. All came from different clans, different regions, and their breastplate had a special insignia, a special marker, a special design of some kind, painted on it, etched into it, carved into it somehow, that represented his personal family. He serves the greater Roman Empire, but he belongs to the family of whatever that crest signified. He kept it close to his heart, metaphorically speaking. You keep the breastplate of Christ on, you keep the cross, that is your insignia, close to your heart. So no matter where you go, you have that with you, the breastplate of righteousness. Next verse, verse 15. Have your feet shod, wrapped on, strapped on, buckled up with the preparation of the gospel of peace. As you visualize the Roman soldier, what starts to come into focus is that every element of this soldier's armor is meticulously designed and perfectly placed, right down from his head to his shoes, on, around his toes. The Roman sandal was a strap of leather wrapped around his ankle up to maybe his, you know, about, well, you can't see him moving, but I didn't, promise. Right about halfway up his leg, his calf, all the way around his foot, strapped with open air so the air could circulate and his feet wouldn't blister, and so on. And they nailed these flat nails into the bottom of the shoe for traction so he wouldn't slip and slide wherever there was ice, I guess. The Romans fought everywhere, right? So they perfectly designed the shoe so that they said, no matter where you are prepared to go take the Roman war to that front. Well, you have to be prepared, no matter where you are, to take this spiritual war to the enemy. You have to be prepared, preparation of the gospel. Wherever you are, no matter where you are, you must be prepared to take the good news of Jesus Christ, no matter if it is a very hostile territory or just somewhere that they don't even know that they need the gospel. Have your feet shod, wrapped, cinched tight, buckled up, prepared to bring the gospel of peace to the lost. Next verse 16, above all. That verse, that word above all doesn't mean most importantly. That's the way we use it. It just literally means on top of everything, because this is the most outward, physically speaking, if you're a Roman centurion, piece of armor. Above every other piece of armor, on top of it all, having the shield of faith. With this, you will be able to quench or put out all the fiery darts of the wicked. The Roman centurion had two kinds of shields. He had an aspis, which was a round shield, about yay by yay, you know, so on. He kept strapped to his back when he needed it. He'd take it off, he'd wear it like a shield, right? Go figure. And then he'd have a sword, and if he had hand-to-hand combat, that was the shield that he used. But if he was going charging into battle, he wouldn't use his aspis because it was only about yay to yay. Your head's exposed, your legs are exposed. You know, you're not doing much good. He had what's called a thurios, which is a big oblong, like an oval-shaped shield that would cover his entire width and length of his body. He would wear that when he was charging forward. And he would not charge alone. No soldier is dumb enough to do this all by himself, because they can just shoot around you and eventually they'll hit you. The Roman soldier took his thurios, his big round shield, and he buckled it next to every other soldier. They formed a wall, if necessary, a big circle if they were protecting something in the middle, but usually just a big wall. So when all the fiery arrows of the enemy came flying at them, their aspis wouldn't do much good, but this big now wall of shield that is now relying on everyone around them can absorb all of those weapons. You don't have this, you're going down. You notice, by the way, that's the word that he uses in shield of faith, is thurios. He never once mentions an aspis, which when you're carrying the thurios, the aspis is strapped to your back. Should a sneaky little booger get behind you and try and shoot you in behind, well, the aspis might catch it. You don't have an aspis. Your backside is completely exposed. You don't have that small round shield to protect your vital organs from attack from behind. So if you think 1 second about stopping and running away from the battlefield, drop your big shield and take off running, your back is going to get shot and you're going to go down. No, he says, stand up for your enemy. Buckle your shield with those around you, your fellow soldiers. Rely on them. You're not doing this alone. You see, that's why the notion of it's just a crutch for weak people is misplaced. Yes, it's a crutch, but I'm not leaning alone. We're all leaning together. Fighting together. We're in the minority, but we all need to stand together. Buckle your shields together. Almost done. Look at verse 17. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Earlier, I think it was in verse 13, he says, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God. Those words, take unto you, is analambano. Lambano means to grab hold of something. Ana means to pick up and grab hold of something. The armor of God that we've said thus far, the breastplate, the shield, the sandals, the girdle, are all on the ground. They're all there. God has personally delivered them to you, tailor-made for you. He just says, pick them up. This one, he uses the word take. It is dekomai. It is receive. Take from me. Not just pick up off the ground, but I am handing to you. You don't pick up the helmet of salvation. You don't save yourself. Jesus gives you salvation, and you from him receive salvation. And how does he illustrate it? By a helmet. If you shoot me in the breastplate, the arrow might go through and puncture me, but I can keep fighting until I bleed out. I can get another, well, not me, but a regular soldier, can keep fighting for maybe an hour, 2 hours, depending on how tough he is. He can fight on for a little while. You hit me in the leg where my sandals are. I might be cut in the leg, but I will hobble. I will continue fighting. I will press on. But you hit me in the head. It doesn't matter how much willpower I have. If I can't see to fight, I can't fight. If I can't hear to fight, I can't fight. If I can't think to fight, I can't fight. The helmet is the most important piece of armor that you have. Paul says, take unto you the helmet that is your salvation. You are saved. Put that in your mind, which is your spiritual head. Put on your mind the truth that you are a Christian. When that Roman soldier sinks on his helmet, all he has left is his trust in his commander who's leading him into battle. He's got every piece of armor on. He's done everything he can do. It's now in the hands of his leader leading him. And he doesn't know whether he's going to go back home to his barracks, his base, or to his family. The Christian soldier sinks on the helmet of salvation with 100% assurance that his leader will not fail him. You might fall and die in this physical world. In fact, guaranteed, probably going to happen. But you will go to heaven someday. Guaranteed, going to happen. You put on the helmet of salvation. You are committing to your mind the assurance that you're fighting the right enemy, the right way, and the right outcome is going to be assured. Last one. Take the helmet of salvation. And then he says, the one and only weapon that you have, take the sword. The Roman soldier had a sword that was about, including handle, about that long. This blade of 3.5-4 feet, maybe at best long, with a little stout handle called a gladius. The Roman soldier took this sword. It was good for stabbing. It was good for slicing. It was good for cutting in all manner of ways, but it was limited. Like any physical sword, it could only cut flesh. You take a better sword. It is not so weak as to only cut flesh. This sword pierces the heart of man. Not his physical blood pumper, the spiritual heart and soul of man. You take this sword, and you don't, like their swords do, take someone from living to death. You take this sword, and you bring someone from death to life again. Spiritual death and sin back to life in Jesus Christ. Take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Think about the Christian armor as you go out. Your commander-in-chief is saying to you, gird up your loins. In other words, prepare yourself to fight. The armor is laying at your feet. If you're a Christian, you've taken the helmet, slide it on, grab your sword, and head out to battle. You're not fighting people. You're fighting the idea of sin itself. But you have the good message, victory in Christ. That's all I've got for you right now. We're going to sing one more song, and then we'll take a break. You can use the restroom or allow anyone coming at 6 to come in. Well, if you came late, and by that I mean on time, because we normally start at 6, but that's late today because we started at 5. So if you came late, you missed some wonderful singing. We had a study of Ephesians chapter 6. So if you've already shut your Bibles from before, or if you haven't yet, open your Bibles to Ephesians 6. We left off at verse 17. I want us to end by looking at Ephesians 6, 18. Ephesians 6, 18. And then we will offer the Lord's Supper, the communion for you who have yet to take it on this Lord's Day. And then we'll dismiss for the evening. Please stay with us. Don't rush out. The weather is not bad. The weather is fine. You're nice and warm and comfortable here, and there's pizza. So please stay and eat the pizza that we bought and provided for you. And eat as much as you want because there's a lot of it there. So don't worry about it. Ephesians 6:18, we talked in the last hour about girding our loins and what that means in the Old Testament literal application, which was hiking up the tunic that the men wore, the long skirts, and tying it around their mid-waist so that it would be like shorts so they could more adequately rush and maneuver and whatever. in battle. And there's a spiritual application to that that we have as Christians. We are to spiritually gird up our loins, spiritually equip ourselves so that we are ready for battle. And we do that by, according to Ephesians 6, adorning ourselves in the whole armor of God. We often, when we study the text, go through 10 through 17. But right after verse 17, which is take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, the very next verse starts with a word that continues the thought, praying. He doesn't start a new thought, otherwise he'd say pray. He says you take the sword of the Spirit and you do so praying, because you're going off into battle. Do soldiers not pray a lot when they go into battle? Well, you are a spiritual soldier fighting a spiritual battle. Of course you ought to be praying, he says in verse 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Thus, every prayer that you make should be done with prayer and supplication, offering words and petitions to the Father in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for the saints. No soldier of God has ever won a battle without adorning himself in God's armor. And I don't mean just in the spiritual sense like we talked about in the last hour. I mean, if you go through the Old Testament and you read the history books like the Judges and the books of Samuel or Solomon, Kings, I should know the books of the Bible, Kings and Chronicles and things where they talk about great battles and victories that are fought and won. And you read, especially in the Judges, great heroes who rose up and fought off armies. You read those kinds of battles. No soldier of God, no army of God, no leader of God's people ever won squat without putting on this spiritual armor. Not putting on an actual breastplate. Not putting on an actual helmet or grabbing an actual sword. They may have had those things, but they did not win with those things. Consider the battle of Jericho, Joshua 6. You don't have to turn there. We're not going to study it. We don't have time. Just in your mind, we're familiar with the concept of the battle of Jericho, the city with the high walls. The people needed to take down that city because it was on their land. Well, they didn't know that. Jericho didn't. Well, tough cookies, it's on our land. That's our promised land. You got to get out. They didn't want to get out, so we're going to force you out. We're going to knock down your walls, walls which have never been knocked down before. And we're going to do it without firing a shot. How did they do it? They walked around the city seven times. On the seventh time, they walked around it seven more times. They blew trumpets, and they shouted really loud, and down the walls came. No weapons were used in the making of that picture. No animals were harmed in the making of that motion picture, and yet they won because they had faith. They adorn themselves in the armor of God. Take the victory of Gideon over the Midianites in Judges chapter 6. One book over, same chapter, Judges 6. How they won that victory, driving out the well-equipped Midianite army with Gideon and his army initially of 30,000 soldiers, whittled down to a sparse number, yet they did not fire a shot. They may have had armor on. I don't know what they brought with them, but they didn't use their armor. How did they win? They snuck in there at night, they used lanterns, pots, and pans, they made a lot of noise, and everyone just killed themselves. And they just stood back and thought, this was easy. How did they do it? They had the armor of God to illustrate that best, at least in my estimation. Take your mindset to probably the most famous one-on-one battle in the Bible. I alluded to it earlier in the previous sermon. If you were to think of all the great battles, I mean one-on-one, you don't get many of those in your Bible. What's the most famous one? What's the one that's most often depicted in children's, you know, Bibles with the visuals? David and Goliath. The great underdog story. The little guy trying to beat the big guy. The little guy Goliath trying to go up against the unstoppable God and getting just royally smacked down. It's the best beatdown of an underdog you'll ever read. David and Goliath. You take that account and you can find David dressed totally in the armor of God. For example, his loins were girded about with truth. David knew he was going to prevail. He knew God was on his side. That's why he said to Solomon, or to Saul, I don't need this armor, and I don't need any armor. I've got all that I need right here. He wasn't talking about his sling or his stones. He meant, I've got all I need with God. He was wrapped around in the truth that God was on his side. He had on a breastplate of righteousness. Was he not a man after God's own heart? Would any of the terrified, cowering soldiers of Israel have been able to defeat Goliath? He would have squashed them like a bug because they had no faith in God. They had no trust in God. But David was a man after God's own heart. Reciprocate that. God was in David's heart. Breastplate of righteousness held close to him, David's relationship was. with God. In fact, that was the whole reason he decided to fight the blaspheming Goliath in the first place. Because Goliath would come down from his lofty perch and he would talk, I almost said talk smack, that would be a little too casual. He's disrespected God by saying, you people, that you serve this God, and yet he has brought no champion out to fight me, the great champion of the Philistines. And David looks around. Is no one going to fight this guy? David, the short little runty redhead, the runt of Jesse's litter, looks around at his big strapping older brothers, and they're all hiding under the bushes. And David says, and he goes, why? Because he has on a breastplate of righteousness. I'm riding the Son of God. This cat's not going to make it. He doesn't stand a chance. His feet were shod with the sandals of the gospel because he spoke good news. Not to Goliath. He may have spoken it directly at Goliath, but the message was to the cowering people behind him. You come to me with a sword and with a shield and with a great army behind you. I come to you in the name of the God of Israel, my Father, and he will smite you and smack you down. He came speaking truth. He had on shoes, ready to speak the good news. His shield was his faith. He brandished it, though you never saw it. It did not glisten when the sunlight hit it. He had no physical shield, but he had on a shield of faith. Knowing as he charged to that great 9-foot-9 monster. We rushed the field last night. We saw Dan Skipper, the monster Dan Skipper. He of many a personal foul penalty. He's only, what, 6'6"? He's 6'10"? He's a monster of a man. 6'10"? Here, just right on cue. Here comes Keith. A monster of a man, if ever there was one. A terrifying presence to stand in. Nothing compared to Goliath. And yet David, the shortest guy in here. I'm not even going to bother. We could pit them against each other and just watch. Goliath could slaughter Keith. No disrespect. Well, a little. But, you know, he could take me out in a heartbeat if I was like those other soldiers. But David wasn't like the other soldiers. He had a shield that would not break when charging against this mighty giant, unfazed by his size. And his helmet was his hope of salvation. How do I know he had on a helmet of salvation? Because he took stones, not swords. He went by himself, not with an army, and he charged, not meekly approached that giant. Why take 5 stones, though? Was he afraid he'd miss? Goliath had 4 brothers, according to 2 Chronicles. I want to say 19, but don't quote me on that. I'll look it up later. Goliath had 4 brothers. I imagine David went a giant hunting after he was done with Goliath. He had 5 stones. He only needed 1 to take down this brute, and he swung it true, and it landed square and knocked down the giant. Why? Because he knew up here, before he ever went to the fight, I've already won. How do you know that, David? Because God's on my side. You ever heard that expression, God plus one's a majority? God is the majority. Get on team God. David was, and David was victorious. The Christian soldier, like David, is a fighter ready for battle. He is constantly watching. That's the verse we opened with in chapter Ephesians 6:18, constantly watching, keeping guard, looking out for whenever his enemy approaches. When it does, he straps on the armor. He heads to battle. He fights because his enemy is relentless, and his only hope to survive is to keep on fighting until his leader calls him home from the battlefield. You just keep on fighting. What about you this evening? How are you as a soldier of the cross? Are your loins girded? Have you strapped on the armor, cinched it tight to your heart, held it out to defend against the enemies of Satan that he throws at you? Is your armor on? Maybe you've never enlisted in the Christian army. Maybe you've got no belt to put on and you have yet to take up the armor. You have an opportunity to become a Christian. It's as easy as pie. You believe in Jesus? You believe Jesus? Do you trust him? Do you believe Jesus? Repent to Jesus. Turn to him by saying you're sorry for all the bad that you've done. Confess your faith in Jesus. Tell other people that what you've done and what you plan to do with Jesus. Be baptized into Jesus. And then just live faithfully for Jesus. Just be faithful. And when Jesus comes back, you'll go live with Jesus forever and ever and ever. If you've not been a faithful Christian, if you've been cowering and hiding instead of stepping up to the plate and fighting the good fight of faith, now is your opportunity to say you're sorry, to get it right, to come to people who love you, who want to lock their shields with you and help you fight the enemy of Satan, the enemy that Satan gives to you. If we can help you in any way, let us know how right now as we stand and sing.